I mean, I struggle with that sometimes, but sometimes I need to be have this attitude where I'm more like Mary, where I'm sitting at his feet and I'm just paying attention to God, where I'm just being still and knowing him. But I believe that Martha learned this lesson. I think Mark, because you see later in the Gospel of John, you see her, the maturity of her faith. She understood some things about Jesus Christ. That after her brother Lazarus died and Jesus comes, she runs up to him and says, "You know what, Jesus, if you were here, my brother wouldn't have died. But even now, God, I know God will give you what you ask for." Look at that level of faith. But not only that, she continues on in her faith saying, "You know what? I know on the last day, my brother will be resurrected." But her faith didn't stop there. Her faith grew up and said, "You know what? You are the Christ, the Son of God, who was to come into the world." I mean, look at Martha. She had to have stopped and really gotten to know who Jesus was. Because we think about great confessions of who Jesus is, and we think of Peter, who says, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." We think of Thomas, who says, "You are my Lord and my God." But then we see that one of the other people in the New Testament that had one of the clearest identification statements of who Jesus is comes from Martha. She came to know Christ. "You are the Christ, the Son of God, the one who was to come into the world." I think about how her faith grew because she had to have taken time to actually focus on the spiritual, to focus on Jesus himself, realizing it's good to serve the Master, but it's better to think and know and worship and glorify the Master. Because the service of the Master will follow after the worship of him, after the consideration of him, after the thanking of him. And then I think of Mary. Mary had it right. She prioritized the spiritual thing. She focused on being still and getting to know Jesus. She sat at his feet and listened to him. And the amazing thing you see about Mary is her devotion. Just think about her godly devotion, this godly woman. Because we know that in that last week when Jesus was about to die, that Jesus was reclining at a home, and then she came with an expensive jar of perfume worth about a year's wages. And then she broke that jar and she poured that jar on Jesus. And she got down on her feet and she washed Jesus' feet with her hair. And she spread that perfume on him. And I just think to myself, what an amazing woman who actually understood the concept of loving Jesus. Loving Jesus and sacrificing for Jesus. And I think about how in that time, a woman's hair was considered her glory. Her beauty, it was a badge of honor. But washing feet was a disgusting task saved for the lowest of the slaves in the house. Yet she considered washing the feet of Jesus more important than her own glory. I just think about how much she had to have loved Jesus. And she brought this expensive jar. Can you imagine giving up something so expensive and something so cherished just to honor Jesus for a moment? I mean, and people were rebuking her. Even Jesus' own apostles were rebuking her for this. And Jesus was saying, "Leave her alone. She's doing right." Time and time again, Mary's being told that she's doing what is right. I mean, think about how much she loved him. Was the sacrifice something that she felt was an obligation? Was it something that she felt was commanded to do? No, we didn't see that. But this was the natural outpouring of her heart saying, "You know what? I love Jesus so much. I want to sacrifice. I want to give. I want to honor. I want to worship because I have taken time in my life to be still and know that Jesus is God. And because of that, I want to honor him with my life." I think about Mary and I think, am I really like her? Do I love Jesus as much as she loved Jesus? I think, would I be willing to give up a year's income just to honor Jesus for a moment? Or think about what's your most prized possession you have? I mean, I think about my house, and most of my house are like furnishings and decorations, things my wife has collected through the years or been given. But what I actually say, this is mine, not mine and Disney's, there's only very few things I own. And so I ask, what's the most expensive things I've probably spent money on? What are the things I've dedicated most of my time and attention to? And I thought, my books. You know, I've read thousands upon thousands of books. I spent a lot of money on books. That's probably my greatest source of wealth, in a sense. And I spent a lot of time, hours upon hours upon hours reading. Would I be able to just give that all to Jesus and without a hesitation, just for a moment, to honor Jesus? Because that's exactly what Mary did. I mean, this wasn't a year-long thing of honoring Jesus. This was a one-time moment. Taking a year's worth of wages of this perfume and just giving it to Jesus and honoring him. And I'm just thinking, that's how I need to be. Why can't I have the faith of Martha that says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, the one who came into this world? And have the devotion of Mary saying, you know what? There's a lot of important things, but you're the most important. If this is something that the world cherishes, this expensive perfume, it's nothing in comparison to you, my Savior. I mean, can you imagine having that faith of Martha? And can you imagine having the devotion and worship of Mary? I mean, these godly women are teaching us something. They're teaching us to take time to really think about Jesus, to spend time getting to know him. I mean, I ask myself, is it hard to love Jesus? I mean, you'd think it'd be easy to love Jesus. You'd think it'd be so easy to worship him, to glorify him, to think about him, to make him the forefront of your mind. But I have to admit, I have a hard time loving Jesus. I really do. I have to pray to God every day asking me to love Jesus. Because you'd think it'd be easy, but the thing is, sometimes my selfishness comes in, and instead of being still and knowing God, I'm being active and doing so that I can think about myself. I struggle with it sometimes because it's so easy to get distracted. It's so easy to get into that mindset of Martha where I'm doing a lot of right things. I'm doing a lot of moral things. I'm doing a lot of different things, but I'm not focusing on the important thing. I'm not focusing on the most important thing. The most important thing is spending time with my Lord, worshiping him, glorifying him, praising him, thanking him. When was the last time we did that? I mean, I see a lot of times people who are discouraged in their faith and they're lacking energy and they say, you know what? They wake up Sunday mornings and they say, I don't want to go to worship service, but I know I need to be there. Or they all look at the watch and say, oh, it's 11:59, I still have a minute to read my Bible. Or they'll say, you know what, did I pray today? Yeah, I prayed for my burrito at lunch, I'm covered. And they minimalize it like that. When all the time, we should be saying, you know, I'm excited to go to worship service. I'm excited to spend time in prayer. I'm excited to worship in song. I'm excited to spend time in the Word of God. I'm excited to evangelize. I'm excited to serve. But all those things won't happen until you put the first thing first, and that is your true worship and glory of God, where you just spend time with Him. Just spend time with Him. That's why it says part of the will of God is just praying to Him and thanking Him and having joy. Because those are the things that inspire all the other things of Christ. The evangelism, the assembly, the Lord's Supper. Because we're worshiping God first. We're glorifying God first. We're knowing God first. And when we do that first, your faith will be rebuilt. Your passion will be reignited. It's kind of like going out with your wife after the date. Things are better in your marriage for a while. And so you realize you should probably keep taking your wife out on a date. Same thing with God. We just need to take time out of our day and say, this time is for God. And you know what? Sometimes it may seem a little bit harsh and say, you know what? Even though I have to neglect some time with my children, I want to teach them. My priority is first to spend time with God. That's a hard thing for me to do. Because I like spending family time. When I have free time, I want to spend it with my family. But one of the best lessons I could teach Paige and teach the future children if I have them through this foster care system is saying, I want to spend time with you and I will spend time with you, but I have to budget time with my God because that's the most important thing. And I want you to learn this lesson too. I think if we truly do that, our faith will be ignited and our passion will be happening. We'll be evangelizing more effectively. We'll be serving more. Don't get into this mindset that I'll just keep going and going and going because you'll get burned out, you'll be tired, you'll be exhausted, and instead of celebration, you'll be bitter in relation to your relationship with Christ. But when you set aside time with Christ and you're really allowing His peace to overcome you, to remember who He is and His thankfulness of the cross and His blessings in your life, that changes your whole life. So I want to challenge you this week or this month, grab one of those calendars.